I'll introduce you and then I'll dim the lights and you can start.
Sure. I did unmute you, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
So welcome everybody. Big hand for our next speaker, Mr. JJ Merelo. And the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much for being here. My name is JJ Merelo. I know it's very bad time because it's pretty much dinner time here in Europe, and in Spain is the time we wake up from the siesta. So anyway, I'm going to talk about this, how to stop programming in C in every single language. Once and for all, you can see that. But anyway, this is me. You know, people put all kind of bios and everything. I don't care. I mean, this is me. This is actually important. That's my Twitter. You got it? Anyway, you're not going to see this, but you know it. Yeah, you probably have seen it already. You know, printf. You know, you start to learn some new language like C, for instance. You use something like this: include studio.h and then printf, whatever. Maybe you have also seen this. Have you seen this? How many of you have seen this? Great, you're great guys, I love you. And maybe even this. This was in Java. It was, once again, the same thing. It was printing something to console, you know, doing some input-output to console. Or maybe even this. This is pretty much the same thing in Scala. So if you go to any tutorial in Go, in Scala, in Clojure, whatever, the first thing you're going to see is something like printf, whatever. I think that's bad. That's very, very incredibly bad. I will tell you why. First, you probably have learned, I mean, how many of you right here are self-taught in programming? So, pretty much everyone. That probably means that, I mean, that means two things. Probably you will be a better programmer because you have been self-taught. Second, the person who taught you knew nothing about the programming language you were learning. You were probably using something like this. Learning C. Because, you know, you were, I mean, think about it, what you did. You were printing to console. You were doing something like including some standard library or whatever. But actually, if you think about it here, you never use that kind of thing. You pretty much never print to console. If you're doing something in production, do you print to console? No, you don't do that. I mean, you print to a log, you do some kind of, you know, you store something in a database, you do something like that. So, I mean, it's like learning something that at the end of the day, when you stop learning, when you have learned everything, they say, okay, you have learned everything, but don't ever do it again. I think it's just kind of dumb. The thing is about the, I mean, you think about all the kind of programming languages you have, the word programming, it's many things, but there are some things that it's not. First is that it's limited. It's not limited to a single language. Once again, think about the way you program. You probably use some language, whichever language. You probably use something like JSON, which is not a Turing complete language, but it's still a language. Then you have to present something, and it's probably some in the web or something that will eventually end up on the web, so you have to know HTML. Then if you have to do something on the client side, you also have to know JavaScript. So first thing is that I think that it's wrong to learn a language all by itself, because eventually you will end up using that language in an ecosystem with many other languages. At least two or three languages. HTML is going to be there, pretty much. JavaScript is going to be there, almost always. You're going to have something like JSON, XML, YAML, something like that. And you have to learn them also. Programming is not monolithic. That means that you're going to program one piece of a program in one language, and then some other part of the program is going to be programmed in a completely different language. Think about microservices. Microservices, they have several good things, but one of them is that you can, every single microservice can be programmed in any language you want. I mean, as long as you respect some API interface or whatever, you can use any language. So it's not monolithic. It's not single-threaded. It's going to run in many computers. It's going to run, even in a single computer, might be concurrent, might be something completely different, something you're not prepared if you start to learning to program, print it to console. And then you're not going to do it by yourself. Every single tutorial, every single book says you have to do that. And then when you do that, you will obtain that. It never says no, you have to do that in the developer branch, and then you have to put this to production, and then everybody else in the team will yell at you because you did it wrong. So, that's what actually happens. You are always programming, and you do it in a repository. Could be Git, could be something else, but you are almost always going to program in a team. Even if you do some open source programming, you're going to put it, you know, out there in the world, and somebody can come up and do a pull request. So you have to know what's a pull request. That kind of thing, I mean, it's incredibly important. You'll never code alone. And then people also focus on the syntax. If you want to do a for, you have to do it this way. If you want to do a switch statement, you have to do it this way. If you want to do whatever, function, subroutine, whatever, you have to do in that other way. I think that's also wrong. You have to focus on best practices. I mean, do you remember when you learned BASIC? How many learned BASIC for the first time? So there was this thing called GoTo. You remember GoTo? So you have to do GoTo, and you can do this GoTo label. And then don't do it. Don't ever do it again. I mean, the syntax is there. You can do many things. And with the syntax, you can do many things wrong. For instance, think about the Scala. You can do for in Scala. You can do if in Scala. But then you shouldn't do it. Because the proper way of doing that is, you know, monadic way. It's, you know, best practice or PHP. I won't say any more about PHP, but think about PHP. Then it's never isolated. So you're the, every programming language is the core of an ecosystem. That happens. Some other languages, at the same time you learn the language, you learn the ecosystem. For instance, think about Scala and think about SVT. It's almost impossible to do anything with Scala if you don't know SVT. Or think about Go. I mean, Go is a language, but it's also an ecosystem because it's a runtime. It's something that, you know, brings dependencies. Think about Node and think about NPM. The ecosystem is built in. Sometimes it's not built in. Sometimes you have to learn. You have to know what's the best way this week to build something in JavaScript, things like that. But you have to learn them. So even if you know perfectly JavaScript, you know the syntax, you know how to do everything, asynchronous, whatever, you still have to know a lot how to deal with NPM or Grunt or Bower or Webpack or Fly or some other. And then it's not proprietary. Some people start to learn a new language and they start to learn it in some proprietary kind of environment. And you say, no, I don't do that. I'm cool, I do open software. But you use Sublime Text. And that's proprietary. And you use IntelliJ, and that's proprietary. And you use some other things like code or something like that. I think that actually coding is the killing app of software. Almost every single programmer working nowadays is using some programming tools that are open source. So I think that we should kickstart programming all over again. We should try to learn programming in a new way. Like, for instance, deal with expressions. Think about expressions. Nobody talks about expressions. Expressions are very cool, are at the core of the language, and they're also very common. If you learn how to do something in a particular language, you probably learn how to do it in three or four or six or seven different languages. I mean, you can only sum things in a particular way with a plus. But some other things like concatenating strings, some many other things, they are done exactly the same in many languages. So expressions are very easy to learn. And also, you can use them from REPLs. You don't even need to compile a language. You don't even need to compile a line of code to work with expressions. If you work with Python, with Persix, with a console, with a developer console in Mozilla or in Chromium, you can pretty much type an expression and you will get the result. So it's like a calculator on steroids, but a very nice calculator. So you can create complex expressions, and you can even create like very little tiny algorithms that allow you to know how everything works. And REPLs are incredibly good. You think about the REPL nowadays, Ruby, REPL, all the REPL. I mean, they are incredible. They work very well. And they allow you to do lots of things. Because you think about programming as something that's creating a program, compiling a program, running a program, deploying a program. It's not. I mean, for some people like journalists, like people who are working in biology, for psychologists, programming is something that they do to get some stuff done. And sometimes expressions are just the thing they need. And when I mean expression, I mean real expression. No variables, no function names, nothing. You can learn a lot of things from expression. and so learn to fail. Every single book says, you have to do this, and then you will obtain the result, and this is OK. Everything is going to be OK. Nothing is going to ever be OK. I mean, everything is going to fail. So one of the first things you need to do is how to work with errors, how to learn the errors. I'm a professor. I teach at the university. One of the single things that they don't, that my students don't know how to do is how to deal with errors. What they do is they start all over again. I mean, they go to Stack Overflow, they copy again the thing, they modify the stuff, and they that error over again. So they look at the error, they look at many different things. They don't even know what to cut and paste into Google to get the error right. And that's because they didn't learn how to fail. Nobody told them that in this particular language, the errors have this structure. You should look at them this way. Look, this is the stack. This is whatever. This is function call. Parse them and try to learn from them and try to fix them, not start all over again. And then something very important. Git goes before open. So you learn to save some program. You learn to put it. But the best practice is always to work in a repository. If only for backup purposes, it's OK. I mean, it's great to work with that. You don't need to actually create a file. You can work with a repo, do a stuff, but when you actually have to use the file, put first the code in a repository. Always, always, because you're going to need it. Open or close or whatever. Git goes before open or goes before save as or whatever. Because repositories are actually the natural environment of programs. And you should always learn to program in a repository. And also learn all languages. OK, not a single language, all of them at the same time. So you're going to need them anyway. So why not put in some example of how this would be done in a different language? I mean, that would be great. That would allow you to learn, because you're going to have to learn languages anyways. I mean, how many languages did, show of hands, how many of you learned one language in the past year? Two languages? You see, I mean, you are learning all the time. You have to learn to learn. You have to learn to change, not say, OK, I have this new thing. What I'm going to do? I'm going to program in C in this other language all over again. No, don't do that, please. And also, if you don't learn all languages, JavaScript and HTML is pretty much the way to go, because JavaScript is, for the time being, it's OK. You can compile other languages to JavaScript. You can compile CoffeeScript. And besides, JavaScript is not a single language. It's got like 1,000. You know, you have ES6, you have TypeScript, you have CoffeeScript, you have whatever. So you're pretty much done with it. I mean, it's a universal language. Also, functions. Every single modern language is functional. So you have to learn functions. Functions are first-class citizens. So the first thing you should learn are functions. Not printing, functions. That's the way to go. Because all languages are functional. JavaScript is functional. Ruby is functional. Even Java is functional. Java 8 is functional. I mean, can you dig that? And code by default. You know, all these languages say, now you compile, and you do the thing, OK, and you put it there, and you run it on your single desktop. No, you're not going to run stuff in your desktop. You're going to deploy it to the cloud. And that's got its own problems. So it's cloud by default. I mean, I know that some people hate the cloud. Even if it's your own cloud, you can use OpenStack, or you can use OpenNebula, whatever. Eventually, you're going to run stuff in the cloud. So when you save something and run something, run it directly on the cloud, on a PaaS, on an infrastructure service, whatever. And so you would say, OK, I have already learned language, so I'm bad, I'm in sync. You know, what can I do? I mean, you can do many things. First, make change. Do it yourself. Teach some other people to a new language. Teach your family. I'm teaching my family language, Perl 6. I'm going to talk about that tomorrow. So. I mean, come by the Perl Dev Room, which is incredible, also in any ways, and learn who they did. And also ask for change. So if you go to some tutorial, if you go to somewhere, you have the power to pay some people to do teaching in your company, tell them to try to do things in a different way. Because we are in 2017, and things are done differently. So the thing is, say goodbye to Hello World. And this is, thank you very much.
So thank you very much.